What's up, everybody? Welcome back to the Game Channel. My name is AJ Gills. How y'all doing? We are going to be sitting down and taking a look at what I believe is the start of this whole Summer Games Fest thing that Jeff Keighley is trying to put out. This is an Xbox gameplay of the Series X and whatnot. Honestly, I'm a little surprised because we're right at the beginning, the first like half hour of what I'm going to link in the description is literally just stream starts in 30 minutes. So this is a lot shorter than I thought it would end up being. I thought the full presentation would be about an hour, but it looks like it's only going to be about 30, 40 minutes, maybe. I don't know what to expect. I haven't spent any time on Twitter today. I've just kind of been avoiding everything until I covered this to actually sit down and come into this fresh. As usual, I'm coming in this fresh eyes, knowing nothing. I haven't seen anything. While I was looking for this video, I did see some of what's going to be here. I know we're going to see some Legion. We're going to see some Valhalla. I actually think we're going to see Yakuza Like a Dragon, Yakuza 7, depending on which one you want to say. So that's a little interesting that that's going to be shown on Xbox, not PlayStation. But it's not surprising these things are going to be shown on Xbox because, hell, we haven't even had a reveal for the PlayStation just yet. So I guess some of that's not too terribly surprising. Honestly, I think what surprises me the most, if you follow the link in the description, you see the like-dislike ratio on this. It's almost, I don't want to say it's almost at 50, but it's, I think, 40, it's, give me a quick second. Yeah, I was right. It's about 40,000 up, 32,000 down. So it's a lot more in the middle than I was expecting. And I know that it's an 8,000 up down. You know, there's an 8,000 difference. So I mean, it is more positive than negative, but it's closer than what I was actually expecting right now. So I don't know. I mean, given the amount of time that we're having this, given that like comment thing, I think some people were thinking this was going to be a little different than what it is. I mean, hell, I think I was thinking this was going to be different than what it is because I was expecting to actually see some gameplay, not this is going to be a tech demo for the Xbox. I have a very strong feeling that that's what it is. I think I misinterpreted what this was going to be. I think I'm going to guess some other people did that as well. But either way, let's hop in. Oh, thank God, audio is being recorded. I don't have to mess with any settings.
Hey everyone, this is Aaron Greenberg from Team Xbox. I'm excited to be coming to you here live from my kitchen. I'm drinking nonstop drinks out of the world's fastest, most powerful fridge. We're moments away from a huge Inside Xbox.
Look at that fridge. Hilarious. Two, I'm really glad we don't have to look at melting Elon Musk. And by the way, yes, that is what I'm going to be calling Jesus Christ. That's what I'm going to be calling Phil Spencer. I stand by. I really don't like the guy. It's kind of weird because before all this, I was talking with my sister's boyfriend. That's a really odd sentence, but she was at his house for a little bit. She came back and he came over for dinner. You know, we're sitting, we're talking. Me and him, we're talking Xbox and this generation, next generation. You know, we're talking games and stuff. And he, unprompted for me, said the exact same thing that I have been saying for the longest freaking time. And I know some of you guys watching the channel, you guys have agreed with me. I know specifically Brian Gade. I believe I've talked the same thing with Rob Stone, a few other guys here on the channel. But I think a lot of us agree. Games are what is going to determine this generation more than anything else. It's really weird. And you know what? In this guy, my sister's boyfriend, that is, again, a really weird thing to say. He's an Xbox guy. He's an Xbox guy this generation. You know, he likes the power and everything and whatnot. And he agrees. He thinks PlayStation is going to win it on games alone. I don't know. It's like I said, I just think that's interesting that it's like I said, somebody unprompted from me came to that same conclusion. Well, not necessarily that, oh my gosh, that's such a big-brained opinion that I came up with. No, it's just, I follow the industry more than he does, you know, or we follow, I how to put it, you know, you guys know me. I kind of, I kind of, I, 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 I'm trying to think the best way to put it. I don't want to say like, oh, I breathe this industry. Like I know everything. That's not what I'm saying, but I feel like I'm fairly informed. I try and stay up to date on the industry. I follow it on Twitter. I try and stay as up to date as possible. He takes a more casual approach to it. And he was able to come to the same thing as me, a guy who, like I said, I think spends a good amount of his time in this industry, either playing games, reading press releases, reading Twitter and all that sort of stuff. So I don't know. Like I said, I found that interesting. Sorry for that interruption.
First, I want to let you know, a lot of people have been wondering, what are we doing this summer? Well, we're not taking the summer off. We're working hard. Teams cannot wait to deliver new games, new reveals, new news for you. So it's time to get hyped. You're going to see today the first ever Xbox Series X gameplay from our partners around the world. Damon Baker and Sarah Bond, who lead our partnership team, have brought some of the best developers and creative teams to the table. They're going to be joined by Jeff, Katarina, and Malik. Team Xbox coming in strong. It's an exciting day. We know fans have been waiting for this. But also, we know you're wondering, what's going on with Xbox Game Studios? You guys have 15 creative teams now around the world. You blew us away at XO19. You blew us away at the Game Awards with Hellblade 2. We know you've got more. Of course we do. And with that, I want to welcome the head of Xbox Game Studios, Matt Booty, to tell us a little more.
Thanks, Aaron. And hi, everybody. I want to start by saying that our first concern is really with the safety of our teams and, of course, their families. And that's why they are all working from home right now, whether it's in Sweden, the UK, Canada, or the US. And I've really been impressed with the ingenuity and the creativity that they've shown to get around some of the challenges of working from home and to keep production moving forward on our great lineup of games. And so we're excited that we will begin unveiling gameplay from our studios starting in July, including some from our newer studios like Double Fine, Ninja Theory, and Obsidian.
Whoa, Matt, it feels like we might have left some off the list there.
Yeah, and Aaron, also 343 and Halo.
That's right. It's time to get hyped. Halo's coming. Halo Infinite, you've been waiting. The world's most anticipated.
All right, so that's interesting. So it sounds like this is more of a they're going to use the third party stuff to kind of show off the tech, while the use the third party stuff to show off the tech, and then do a little bit more focused. Here's our first party studios and everything. Sometime in July. Okay, so that makes a little bit more sense. If I can take a second here to kind of just talk about the presentation of this. So far, I really like this. You know, I mean, this guy, he's very personable. Matt Booney, a nice guy, a little more scripted than this dude right here. But you know what? I'm really enjoying his energy. Again, he seems like he's playing it up a little bit, kind of like I do. Like I play up my reactions a little bit sometimes. But the core love and the core you can tell that he cares about what he's doing. That it's not just a presser. That's always what I get out of Phil Spencer, and it's the core reason why I'm not a fan of him. Everything that just comes from him just sounds so corporate and just sounds so prepared statement X. It just I really don't like it. It's one of my big issues with Phil Spencer, and past couple times I've paused, I've kind of gotten off into the weeds on a different topic. But something else I wanted to bring up, I saw this article I think yesterday or the day before, I can't remember, but apparently Xbox isn't just going to be launching one Xbox this generation. Well, I mean, obviously, you know, there's probably going to be a mid-generation console like there always is. But what Xbox is going to apparently do, they're going to release the Series X, and I think it's called the Series L or something. As far as I can understand it, it is going to be a cheaper alternative to the next-gen hardware. It'll run at not the full 4K. It'll run at 1080 and everything. And I'm sitting here going, because again, I'm having this conversation with this guy today, and me and him were talking, and I said, you know, PlayStation's probably going to hit that 500, 550, and everybody's acting like Xbox is going to undercut them or over. Xbox is probably going to price match. I'm going to guess both the Series X and the PS5 are both going to come in at around the 500, 550 mark. That's my guess, and that's what I expect. Now, who the hell knows? I mean, right now, there is some big question with Microsoft being more of an American company. I'm really curious to see, are prices going to have to go up, because there's a whole thing right now in America pushing away from Chinese manufacturing to move to more American manufacturing, again, with this whole viral crisis and pandemic and whatnot. I'm not sure, you know, how that's if and slash how that's going to affect Xbox for this current generation. So that could push price up. Although, again, we've been hearing the same thing with PlayStation 5, that prices might be being affected by higher cost of parts, again, due to manufacturing issues. So this is one of those that the longer we go on, I can maybe see the case that both consoles come in at 600, but I still think that they're both going to push and maybe even sell at a loss to go for the 500, 550. Because I think 500, 550 is marketable. I think that's a selling point. That's a price point that you can sell to people of, look, this is a I don't want to say high class item. It's a big ticket, boutique sort of just luxury item. So I think you can sell 500, 550. I think that 600 mark is where you hit the, nope, I'm out. I think, like I said, I just because it's the next gen, it's going to be a little bit more expensive than previous generations. It's just how it goes. It's the game. But I think you can market 500, 550. And again, my thoughts clear on the 600 mark. Me and him also came to this consensus that, or he said he thinks that Xbox is going to undercut PS5 by about $100. And I said, I think that they will, but not with the Series X. That's what the Series L thing is. It's supposed to be a cheaper alternative. Again, because I was reading this article, and that's what they're saying. This is supposed to be a cheaper alternative. I don't know if it's going to be at launch or if it might be slightly after launch. But basically, I'm sitting going, if Xbox undercuts PlayStation in price, that's how they're going to do it. They're going to say, here's the Series X. It's your 4K, your high dynamic range, all those other console buzzwords that I'm not 100% sure what they mean, because I'm not that, you know, tech literate, if I'm going to be entirely honest. So they're going to do that at the full price. It's going to match the PS5. And then they're going to undercut by 100 for this. Here's this souped up 1080, just typical high def console that's also going to be able to run the next gen consoles. See, now, this is really interesting, because I could see where that could backfire and that could be a massive success. Because on the one hand, I can see where the success is. I mean, it's $100 cheaper than your competitor. It's a chance to buy into the next generation. You know, it's not as an intimidating price necessarily as that 500 mark, coming in at pretty much what the Xbox and PS4 cost at launch. Okay, I can see that. The downside is, and where I could see people like me and other detractors who would say, so basically I'm spending $400 for a souped up Xbox One X. Okay. You know, it's if you're going to do that, then don't go, for your exclusives, then don't go straight to next gen. Just release them for both for a little bit until people have really moved up and bought the next generation of console. That's kind of how I see it. I'm like, I think that it's one of those that there's kind of two ways you want to look at it. You want to look at it, it's a neat way to kind of buy in for less money for the next gen. That's cool, but it's also, like I said, you're basically playing a souped up Xbox One X and you're not getting the full features of next gen mixed with, you could just make your games for both next and current gen for a year or two till people completely switch over. I for some reason I think that would be easier than making a whole nother console with lower specs than your main console. It's like, this is always kind of my thing with Xbox. They're always so overly complicated. It's here's Game Pass, and I'm still not 100% sure how the hell Game Pass works. I've tried figuring out and all that. I'm like, you know, if I buy my game on one platform, I can have it on the other, or is it a, you know, it's like I get free games every month, or like, what exactly is it? Just and at some point I'm like, you know what, screw this, I'm just gonna keep my Xbox Gold membership and be done. I have a similar thing with PlayStation, but I still think theirs is still a little easier to understand, between PlayStation View now and all that other stuff. Generally, I have the same theory with that one, though. I'm gonna have my PS Plus. But again, Xbox just always seems like they're trying to be just too smart. You know, we're gonna try and just be just too out there, too new of an idea. It's just you're overreaching. What's the expression? You're getting ahead of your skis. That's, I think, something that that's an idiom that I've used to explain Xbox a lot. It's like they're just trying to do too much instead of focusing on a simple idea of, let's just make great games. Which, again, I like the idea of Hellblade, but focusing on Halo, guess what? Let's be honest, it's a dead franchise. Not dead, but, you know, it's just, it's nowhere near what it was. And, you know, they're like, oh, we have all these first-party studios. Okay. What the hell have you spent the last couple of years building? I mean, you know, it kind of felt like you're just buying time until this next generation of hardware, while PlayStation spent the last couple of years on the previous generation of hardware really building their library. And I said this today, it's while Xbox just kind of ran out the clock at the end of this generation. Really, I kind of think they did that in the 360 generation too. PlayStation in the PS3 generation and the PS4 generation. To different aspects, because PS3 was kind of behind Xbox, and you could argue that they... I don't know. I think you could argue that Xbox won last generation. You can argue that PlayStation 3 won it. It's a whole thing. Last generation isn't as clear as this generation's. But either way, the PS3, they picked it up right there at the end. I think PlayStation did the same thing. I mean, we've had three or four fantastic years of PlayStation. Just exclusive after exclusive after exclusive. And now I get it. There are some people, because again, this guy I was talking to today, he wasn't a fan of the exclusives and how it's, you know, I now have to buy both consoles to play everything. And I'm like, well, that I get that. As a consumer, I can understand why that's a little frustrating. At the same time, if you're trying to market a console, one of the best ways to do it is exclusive. So it's one of those that you kind of have to remove yourself from it and look at it from an industry perspective. I'm sorry, I'm kind of getting off into the weeds here. But basically what I'm trying to say is, Xbox wants to show off these games, but again, it's like I said, I don't think they've really built any massive goodwill. I don't think that they've built any massive franchise. I mean, maybe Ori. They could maybe do more State of Decay. But I mean, you know, Forza, fine. Forza's a juggernaut, and it will probably always be a juggernaut. It's one of those that it's kind of a weird genre of game that isn't, I don't think, going, that isn't going to draw in everyone. Excuse me. No game draws in everyone, but you get what I mean. It's a smaller, in my opinion, a smaller group of people that I think are going to be drawn in by Forza, that are going to buy an Xbox for Forza. While I think PlayStation is focused so heavily on these great stories and these great franchises and everything, Xbox, it's the idea of Forza. Okay, great. You know, it's like, well, what else do they do? You know, we got Sea of Thieves. That's not going to become a franchise. Gears of War, I mean, it's been on the decline, honestly, probably since 3. Let's be honest. By the time Gears 4 came out, I think it had already pretty much left. I think the thing that kept it alive a little longer is the nostalgia. Kind of like Halo, but I think Halo's worn out its welcome. I think Gears has worn out its welcome. It's like I said, I think Microsoft hasn't done anything to really build new franchises. I think Nintendo sort of ran into a similar issue, but I think that they're revitalizing some of these older franchises with new gameplay ideas. I mean, hell, just look at Breath of the Wild with Zelda. I think that's an example of that. I think while they're innovating on the gameplay side, PlayStation is innovating on the idea of that, you know, we're finding new stories to tell. We're starting new franchises. We're taking existing IPs and changing them, kind of like Spider-Man and God of War. And then they're taking stuff like Horizon. They're continuing on with The Last of Us. You know, I mean, and then again, look at all the other first party studios that they own, just franchises that are dead or that have just been on the shelf for so long. You know, I've brought up Sly Cooper. They've got Jack, Resistance. You know, all that stuff that fucking Insomniac has. I know I've gone into the weeds and I've probably jumped around a little bit on topics, but basically what I'm trying to get at here is what this guy's saying. It's good that Xbox is really trying to kind of show what they've got in terms of games. I just think that they are so behind the eight ball when compared to PlayStation, because I think PlayStation doesn't even really need to come out and say, hey, here's some of the, you know, I mean, unless they're going to surprise us with some stuff, but it's like, you know, but it's, they can come out and say, hey, God of War 2 is happening. Yeah, we knew that, but show me a cool trailer anyways. But we know what to expect from that. I think with Xbox, it's a lot more of an unknown entity, which I think hurts them going into the next generation. That's my take. I'm sorry it took me so long to get there. I just kind of got lost in my brain. God damn it, I've been ranting here. I am so sorry.
Anticipated game, July, market calendars, Xbox Game Studios. We've got teams around the world that are working on big surprises, big reveals for you. I could not be more excited. I can tell you we're going to work every week between now and then to deliver for our fans. But today, we're going to put the spotlight on our partners and let them shine and show you what Xbox Series X gameplay looked like. Let's have a go.
So sorry about that, guys. After that rant, I took a drink of water and I about died. See, that's a very interesting thing that I just said there. Being optimized for Xbox Series X, so they're not so what we're seeing now, is this running on an Xbox Series X, or is this going to be like that E3 thing where it's like, oh, this is in-engine stuff, but really it's being run by a super high-powered PC in the background? I don't know. That I don't know why, but just seeing it saying optimized is kind of weird for me. Like I said, I might be reading something into it. Excuse me, I'm so sorry. Titanfall? Yeah, this is Titanfall. At least it kind of looks like that. I mean, the movement's right, the guns look right. What the hell? Okay, the sword's throwing me off. It's cool. Look, I get it. It's supposed to look epic and everything, but all this wind and everything blowing away, it instead of just looking good, it looks, I don't know, just everything looks shaky. The hell is this? Okay.
What you just witnessed was Bright Memory Infinite from Playism, created from the ground up by a single individual at FYQD Studio in China. Developers are using the hardware to achieve their dreams and their nightmares in amazing ways, using the power to optimize their games the way they want. You know, higher resolutions, crazy frame rates, ray tracing, and yes, faster in-game load times. But it's also awesome to see the partner support for smart delivery, ensuring that fans only have to purchase the game once to enjoy it on whichever Xbox system they own or will own in the future. So, over the next...
And see, that's another reason why I sit and go, then why the hell would I buy your cheaper next-gen platform with this... with that smart delivery thing? I mean, that's a cool idea, I will say. But that it kind of seems like, well, but if I can play it on my Xbox One or my current gen platform, why would I buy up to your mid tier next gen platform when I could just save up and buy your real next gen platform down the line? I don't know. Maybe I'm misunderstanding what this spec down version is going to be, when it's going to come out. But again, if it's at launch, it just seems like it's going to get in the way, and it's going to be a weird decision on my part. But either way, I'm trying to compliment Xbox, and I can't help but be negative. I do like the smart delivery idea. I do think that that's a very nice consumer friendly idea. Again, my question, I guess my only real question about what we just saw was, what the hell was it? I mean, I get it. It's built from the ground up, ray tracing, all these buzzwords, but what was it? Tell me what the game is about. Try and sell me on that. You know, can I only play it on Xbox? Is it going to be cross-platform? What is it? That's what I want to know.
Next 25 minutes, we're going to debut just a slice of the amazing next-gen games you can expect from our partners this holiday and early next year. And because we read the interwebs, Everything you see here will highlight the in-game experience, with actual gameplay captured in-engine to give you the best sense of what to expect when Xbox Series X launches later this year. So, sit back, relax, and enjoy the following dreams being powered by Xbox.
I mean, see, he says they're partners, but the thing is, that wasn't... we're gonna see Assassin's Creed stuff later. So I mean, it's clearly not just Xbox stuff. I don't know. I'd have to look into that game more. If anybody can tell me in the comments, you know, wants to look it up themselves before I do it, let me know. Okay. Did Xbox pick up Codemasters? Did they bring them into the Xbox Studios? I remember seeing something about Codemasters recently. I just can't remember what it was. I'm gonna guess this is gonna be another dirt game. I mean, this doesn't look Forza-ish. Oh, wow, we're already at Dirt 5? I was right, it's a dirt game. Okay, cool. Damn, this looks really familiar to me. The hell is this? That just looks like a weird penis. What the fuck? I'd also like them to kind of decide, are they going to show us gameplay, or are they going to show us trailers? Are they going to show us both? They made it seem like we're going to see only gameplay, but this is clearly a trailer. Oh, that's not weird. Okay. You can't just show me that trailer and not explain anything from that. Oh my god. Okay, so this is gonna be like how they ran their E3 presentations. This is gonna be rapid fire crap.
Together.
I mean crap as in stuff, not crap as in crap. You get what I mean. Chaos.
Each trial, each tribulation, we have overcome. Now we live in an age of unprecedented peace. Have prevailed thanks to her. Let her ascension serve as proof of our righteousness. It is in her honor that we strive for Chorus.
Yeah. This ends with us.
Okay. Cool.
See, this is kind of what I've been getting at when I've been saying that PlayStation has an advantage going into the next generation because they've already established a lot of franchises and a lot of games that they can easily sell next gen with on the PS4. All this stuff we keep seeing all of this, you know. And again, maybe this is because this stuff is not first party studios as far as I can tell, because last I checked, Codemasters was not a first party studio. I don't know. I've not heard of Ebb Games. I mean, that Scorn looked cool. I just want to know what the hell that thing's about. Same with that last one. I mean, it looks cool, but I don't know anything really about it. It was a cool trailer, but it isn't enough to hook me on your platform. You know, it doesn't hook me to buy a $500 console to play Scorn, especially if I could play Scorn on either platform. That's my question. I'm like, are these Xbox exclusive games? Like, can we put exclusive? Can we put third party studio? Can we put something like that and kind of tell me what the hell I'm looking at? Because if you're selling these as, oh, you can only play this on Xbox, but I can't, but I can play it on elsewhere. And that's weird. And I mean, hell, if they're partnering with them, fine, whatever. But again, I would like to know if I could play these on other platforms. Because again, that's going to affect my purchasing decisions. If I was only going to buy one, I keep saying this, I'm going to buy both. That's just the, you know, that's kind of where I'm at. I'm going to bite the bullet and just drop that cash. But yeah, man, back to my original point, I'm sorry. But yeah, I think PlayStation has done the legwork now to establish franchises or games that we would like to see turn into franchises that they can bring in and easily market the next-gen console, that you have a good semblance of what you're going to get. I think with Xbox, it's a little bit of a crapshoot right now. We really don't know. That's a big issue. So give me a quick second. I'm going to grab another bottle of water, try and not be coughing. All right, I think I'm back amongst the world of the living. Okay, so while I was doing that, I kind of was taking some time, kind of googling some stuff just to see what's going on. As far as Dirt 5, cross platform, Scorn, from everything I can see, is going to be an Xbox exclusive, maybe a timed exclusive. I don't know. I'm gonna guess this is kind of like a second party deal, not a. Because I don't think they're a first party studio, so I don't really know with Scorn. And I didn't look up the last one because, in all honesty, I'm not a big flying game fan. Sorry. But no, I still think my point stands about this. I don't get why you're showing a mix of third party and first party games. Look, I lead with your first parties and then at the end, maybe show us some Assassin's Creed, or, you know, if you want to show some third-party stuff, whatever, you know, if you want to show the big stuff that you know is going to be on cross-platform, I guess that's, you can, but right now, if I was Xbox, I'd be focusing on my first-party studios and showing that, and not, here's Dirt 5, which you can play on anything, here's this that you can play on anything, here's this that you can play on anything. That's just, that's a weird decision, in my opinion. But, I either way, that's like I said, I think that's an odd choice for this stage in the marketing campaign. Ooh, Madden.
What's up, everybody?
This is going to be an Xbox exclusive. It's
Patrick Mahomes, quarterback for the Super Bowl champion Kansas City Chiefs. I hope all of y'all been staying home, staying safe, and playing a ton of video games together. But hey, I'm here because I have a privilege of telling you this. Madden 21 is coming to Xbox Series X, and I can't wait to get my hands on it. It's been a journey that's older than me, and I was lucky enough to be a part of it this year. Like they say, you have to know where you've been to know where you're about to go.
See, I like how they're kind of selling that as, oh, it's coming to Xbox Series X. Yeah, no shit. It's also going to PlayStation. Unless somehow they got, you know, somehow Madden got an exclusivity deal with Xbox, but yet PlayStation is losing the show.
They'll look to throw. throw on third down.
Yeah, you can see that Brady to Gronkowski pass in this year's Madden. They're playing for Tampa Bay. Inside the 10. Still can't believe that happened, but whatever. I'm not here to talk football.
There's loads of Madden 21 news coming soon. And the game isn't just about what you can see. It's about what you can feel. But here's the best news. When you buy Madden NFL 21 on Xbox One, you get it free on Xbox Series X. I'm looking forward to it, and honestly, I'm ready to just get back on the field. Enjoy the rest of the show, and get ready to feel next level with EA Sports.
Okay, I get it. You can stop pushing that smart... Well, I guess it's a good idea to push that smart
huge
delivery.
Thanks to EA for giving us that sneak peek at Madden.
Sneak peek? What the f*** did we just see? We just saw Patrick Mahomes talk to us and saw old clips of the NFL mixed with Madden. I mean, hell, the full release, the full announcement and everything, it's going to be a very esports-heavy thing as well. It's going to be at EA Play, that's June 11th, I think. But no, again, I get it. The smart delivery thing is a really good idea. I've said it before. You can tone it down a little bit, but at the same time, I get it. You want to make sure people are remembering smart delivery, all this. You know, I get it. You're pushing it, but at the same time, I don't know. Let the game lead. But again, when you're trying to sell yourself as you play Madden on this, that just you see. By that point, I feel like you're scraping the bottom of the barrel.
21 optimized for Xbox Series X. I mean, that was awesome.
What?
My name is Sarah Bond.
Whatever.
And I lead partnerships for Xbox, which means I get to work with the thousands of developers and creators around the globe that are creating games on, with, and for Microsoft platforms. I just love my job because it's all about connecting creators and publishers with our fans around something that they love, games. And boy, have they been busy. They are creating right now games that are going to define the generation.
All right, other than the...
that are just going to blow your mind away. And I am thrilled to share with you that every major publisher worldwide is developing for Xbox. And
we and PlayStation as well.
Hundreds of games coming to Xbox Series X in 2021. The support, it has just been tremendous, guys. I have never seen partners as excited about Xbox and Xbox Series X as they are right now. So why don't we take a look and see more of the great games that they have been working on.
Okay, I get it. You're hyping up your console. I get it. I need to start looking at this from a PR perspective, from their point of view, that this is what this is. This is PR for their console. Just what she just did, she was not necessary to this. She was overly scripted. She had no energy to it. It's just like listening to Phil Spencer. That was something I'd expect to see at E3, where they bring out, and here's all the new studios that we've pulled in. We're not going to show you anything, but we're going to show you all the studio logos. Who gives a shit? Oh, check it out. 2K Games is developing for Xbox. Yeah, who would have thought? Again, so many of those platforms in there. I'm like, okay, these are not first-party studios. These are studios that you can find games that are going to come to, you know, that are going to all platforms. That frustrates me a little bit. But again, I get it. At some level, I have to look at this as not the ridiculousness of that. I'm trying to think how to put it. It's ridiculous. You have to tell people that, but at the same time, it's like I said, I have to look at this more from a PR perspective and understand that yes, this is to sell units, and I guess that's what you're doing. But I still feel like you just showed me something really just pointless. That's my opinion on it. Okay. Oh my god, look at the face. Oh, then that's cool.
Show, second balcony.
So Seth, this is a... I saw that, right? It's a paradox, that world of darkness. So this is probably gonna be... Is this Vampire the Masquerade Bloodlines? Yeah, this is Bloodlines 2.
Let's show them how we do. Everyone grab a limb.
Maybe.
Bye-bye now.
I think that's what this is. Because again, everything's making sense. World of Darkness, Paradox. Oh yeah, that's, yeah, that. Jumping up onto that, building. Yep, her. Yep, this is Vampire 2. Which I'm very okay with. I'm actually quite excited for this game. Okay, that is really cool. I'm sorry, I know, it's really fucked up watching that serial killer guy with the eyes and everything, but oh man, it's really cool looking. All right, you know what? You know what? I mean, at least I'm pretty sure that's not going to be an Xbox exclusive. I'm pretty sure that's coming to PlayStation as well. On the one hand, yeah, I know I've been complaining already. I'm not going to repeat myself on the whole third part, third party thing during this presentation. I'll mostly give you a pass on it for this one because, god damn it, that trailer was cool. I am so excited for that game. And that's not true. I have played Bloodlines the Masquerade, but I haven't played a whole hell of a lot of it. I have it on Steam. That game, if you can get... I'm with a lot of people. If you can get past the bugs and just the weird jankiness of the... I think, what, it ran on Unity, didn't it? It was the Unity engine. But, you know, if you can get past some of the jankiness of Masquerade Bloodlines, that game had a lot of really cool things in it. Had a lot of really interesting ways to play. It was a really cool RPG that kind of fused that sort of tabletop aesthetic with a true 3D, action game, I guess. I'm really pumped up for Bloodlines 2, and it's a game I haven't thought about in a while until that trailer. But god damn, that opening bit with the people, you know, with their mouths pulled open by those fish hooks. God. I am on board. You know what, Xbox? You might have gotten me to play that on Xbox. Maybe. I don't know. It depends on how much I want the trophies.
Oh, Harry. What have you done? I've traveled so very far to find you.
Okay.
Strange that your trail ends here. The very island of my dreams. When you left, I was withering away. But here, on this extraordinary isle, I dare say I've found my strength again. I'm scared of what it means.
This kind of reminds me of,
deep within.
Firewatch.
Whispers of things long forgotten. Will we be forgotten too? What did you find here, Harry?
Yeah, I mean, you get what I'm saying? It kind of looked like Firewatch. It even reminded me a little bit of that, that game that was being, I think, done by the same team was Campo Santo. I think they were doing a second game that we haven't heard of from in a long time. It was like in a pyramid or something. Either way, it looked cool, but I don't know. I probably wouldn't play it. It didn't look like it's for me.
Most people have contracted their entire lives away to get here. Workers or indents, slaves in all but name.
Group Arcology on Velas has shut down. If the latter is true, corporate ground teams will already be moving in.
This is a crisis supernova. The Ascent Group has collapsed. We have a shot at true independence. I won't let it go to waste.
We wish to test your abilities by giving you a special assignment. Find out what happened.
Okay.
It looks like we're gonna have to work together on this one. Let's get it done!
I mean, it's got a really cool aesthetic, but at the same time, at the end of the day, it just looks like your typical twin-stick shooter. Nothing. See, this is what I'm saying. I love how they're putting so much power into the Xbox. Again, I feel like so many of their studios make these kind of like really cool sounding, but not tech-focused indie games. You know, I mean, I don't know. I mean, I guess some of those cutscenes looked really stuff looked really pretty, but at the same time, it kind of comes down to, is that is that even a first party game? And the other question that I have about The Ascent was, what we were watching was actually rendered in engine. I don't know. I mean, again, I still think it was a weird idea to show this stuff, to show third party games, during this, but, yeah, again, I still stand by my whole thing that it when Xbox was buying up studios, it just kept looking like every studio they picked up, I'm like, okay, they do small artistic, like, kind of indie projects, small artistic indie projects, and artistic indie projects. I'm like, that stuff's cool, but, oh, well, we have this console that can run all this 5K stuff and all that. I'm like, well, okay, but you don't have the studios that really make use of that. Like, don't get me wrong. I mean, I there's nothing wrong with doing the indie stuff, but where's your big AAA stuff that's supposed to draw me in there? Because PlayStation's got a lot of that. Maybe you could argue PlayStation doesn't have enough small indie stuff, but that's, you know, we can have that discussion. But still, they don't have that big flashy stuff to draw me in like I think PlayStation has. This is the point I keep making. Games are going to decide this, and this is not... So many of the things that we're seeing here, I'm like, okay, that looks really cool. Probably not going to play it, if I'm going to be entirely honest. Silent Hill game? Okay. Interesting. I don't know how to react to that.
Hi. Hope you enjoyed the reveal of The Medium, our next-gen psychological horror game. We're very excited to announce that we're working on the project in cooperation with Akira Yamaoka, the legendary composer best known for the Silent Hill series.
There we go. That explains it. We'll
reveal soon, so stay tuned.
That explains why I was looking at that going, why does this look kind of like Silent Hill? I also believe this one is cross-platform. I think I saw this one in a list of things that it's going to be cross. Okay, this one's also, this has got to be another cross-platform. I mean, if it's come from Bandai. I like the look of it, though. Okay, there's my seizure.
I'm Yuito Sumeragi. My power is psychokinesis. Ready? Go!
Alright, throw in some hot waifus and I am in. Just kidding. Nah, I'm sold. I'm in. It looks fun. Nice hack, kind of like a hack and slash sort of action game. I like the whole psychokinetic powers thing. I mean, it's very anime. Maybe a little on the typical side. This looks familiar. Oh my god, what? Oh my god, what game am I thinking of? You fought bugs, you were on a frozen planet world. Was it like, I can't remember, were they like early Xbox 360 games? Can't think what they were. You were on like an ice planet, you had to worry about, fucking, your heat and everything like that. I can't remember, that's what that opening bit reminded me. What is this, gonna be Dino Crisis? We're looking at the next Turok. I don't know. I'm running out of jokes. Okay. Dinosaur shoot 'em up. I'm in. Sold. Oh, finally. Look, just give us a release date. Give us a release date. Oh, god damn it. Holy crap, Majima's still gonna be here? Oh, hell yes! Sold. I'm playing on PlayStation, obviously, but which I'm really surprised. This was shown at an Xbox thing, but whatever. I'm fucking sold, man. I fucking A, man. I am so excited about this. I fucking love the Yakuza franchise. I love how big, dumb, and goofy they are. I mean, I've got my remaster trilogy now, or my the 3, 4, 5 remasters, and I'm kind of working my way through them in my spare time. Oh my God, I can't freaking wait. Like, I love the story concept for this, you know, because his story seems to be very much like Kiryu's in a way, you know, because what, yeah, Ichi, I think is his name. It's very much like Kiryu's, you know, he kind of goes to jail for a crime that he didn't commit, you know, I mean, because it looks, I mean, under different circumstances, Kiryu was covering for his friend? You know, he's covering for his friend. In this one, it looks like Ichi's doing it for the family. You know, they kind of come out of prison and are kind of thrown to the wolves. You know, they kind of have to find a way to survive. I mean, Ichi's in kind of a worse situation. You know, I mean, like, he does this big thing for the family, and then he's basically shit on, he's shot, and he kind of left for dead. I think they're ramping up the craziness for this one, because it looks like they're summoning, and, you know, like, you're summoning giant lobsters and all this weird crap. The weird, like, turn-based battle system is going to be really interesting, and I really want to play with it, how they're kind of getting rid of it being an action game and everything. I don't know. I mean, we didn't see an English voice track there, but I'm kind of hoping there will be one. I mean, they did that with Judgment, and I'd really like to see that make a comeback. But I think, in a way, what I'm really excited for is just this game to be ridiculous. It's just going to be fun, it's gonna be dumb, it's gonna be a Yakuza, you know what I mean. It's gonna have its serious bits, and it's gonna have its crime Yakuza drama, but it's gonna have plenty of that goofy shit that I love the Yakuza franchise for. I don't know, maybe they'll take a more lighthearted approach, now that they've kind of gotten rid of Kiryu, who's much more of a stoic character, because Ichi doesn't seem to be that way. He seems to be a little more crazy, a little bit more of a loose cannon, while Kiryu was very stoic, very, very calm sort of presence. So I don't know, maybe it will be a little bit more goofy, a little bit more lighthearted than the previous Yakuza games, but even then I'm fine with that, because again, this series I think has found that I trust the people behind this franchise, basically, is what I'm saying. I really like Judgment. I kind of fell off of it because I don't know, its premise kind of wore a little thin. I mean, I had some issues with it. It's kind of why I haven't, that LP is just kind of sitting on my board right now. I plan to get back to it. Maybe sometime this month if I can, depending on what I can finish, what I can't. But I think that game, they really went more serious. I mean, there is goofy stuff in it, but for the most part, it's a much more serious game than in the past. But yeah, I've been excited for Like a Dragon for a long time, and I can't wait to see what Ryuga Gotoku can do with that thing.
こんにちは。セガの名越俊郎です。いよいよこの発表ができる日が参りました。シリーズの最新作である、ヤクザ・ライク・ア・ドラゴンを、Launch
Slate!
シリーズ Xのローンチタイトルとして、そして Xbox One や Windows 10で発売する運びとなりました。全世界のファンはもちろんですね、初めて このタイトルを手にする方にも楽しんでいただきたいなというふうに考えております。ゲームの限界に挑戦する龍河如くスタジオの新たなる挑戦をぜひ見届けていただきたいなというふうに考えております。ヤクザ、ライク・ア・ドラゴンをぜひよろしくお願いします。
You know, I mean something else that's kind of cool, because he mentioned for franchise, you know, basically for fans and newcomers alike, I think this is the perfect place to jump on. Because, I mean, yes, this is Yakuza 7, but it's like they added the subtitle. This is Yakuza Like a Dragon. This is its own thing. I'm trying to remember. I can't remember all the details. I know it focuses on separate families. It's in a different part of Japan, isn't it? I could be wrong on that, but I don't think it takes place in Kamurocho and everything like that. It's its own thing. There are new families. Kiryu, as far as I know, isn't going to make an appearance. I mean, he might cameo, but he's not going to be a big focus in it. I mean, we saw we saw Majima. There we go. For some, I'm like Midoriya, and I'm like, that's not a character from Hero no Academia. Is that what that's from? Either way, you know, we saw Majima, so, you know, at least we know that the Mad Dog's going to be coming back, which, good. I mean, you need the Mad Dog.
I hope you all enjoyed this brief peek at just some of the titles we have lined up for Xbox Series X. This is just the beginning. And personally, I can't wait to get immersed in these amazing games. But until then, I'm just going to have to live out that fantasy via custom backgrounds in Microsoft Teams. How about I try out a few now? Maybe we'll go into the world of Scarlet Nexus, or maybe I could tear up the streets in Dirt 5, or, well, here's a quick view of Phil Spencer's home office. Oh, wait a second. We've got this inside look at the next Assassin's Creed game. So with that, I'm going to leave you with the gameplay debut of the highly anticipated Assassin's Creed Valhalla for Xbox Series X. Huge thanks to all of our partners for their hard work during these difficult times, and to you at home for joining us. Stay tuned to go behind the scenes with a few of the creators of today's lineup and hear more about their thoughts on the next generation of game development. I'll see you later this summer for even more content premieres and announcements from Xbox Game Studios and our partners worldwide. Thanks so much.
I don't know. I thought we were also going to be seeing some Watch Dogs Legion stuff, but I guess not. I was told this would be gameplay. This looks like a freaking trailer. I'm very upset about that. Oh God, are we gonna have a bird following us again? I'd kind of like to get rid of that. It's a cool idea, but I don't know. I mean, I get it. It's a raven. It's the Loki? I don't know. You know, I get it. It's a raven. It's, you know, it's the representation of Odin. I get the purpose of the raven. I'm just like, please tell me it's not going to follow us and be like Senu or whatever the name of the bird in Odyssey was. Nope, looks like we're gonna actually have a bird companion again.
Few titles command the respect.
What the fuck? That was not gameplay, you
garnered. And today,
don't lie.
Talk about Assassin's Creed Valhalla with its creative director, Ashraf Ismail, who's joining us from Montreal, Canada. Bienvenue to Inside Xbox.
Okay, look, I like I said, they better show gameplay and not just that little sizzle trailer or whatever, and then just talk to Ashraf. I think I was talking with Brian Gade about this in the comments of the little Assassin's Creed special or whatever I did for the last weekly show. Ashraf is one of the biggest reasons why I have some faith, why I have faith in this game. This guy has been connected to some very good Assassin's Creed. I mean, he's creative director on 4. Was he creative director on Origins? I know he was connected to it. I just can't remember what his exact title was. I don't know if he was a part of Odyssey. Oddly enough, I kind of played about an hour of Odyssey last night. You know, I kind of loaded it up on the PlayStation, on my PS4, and just to kind of remember things. Just kind of a rundown of things I'd like to see changed real quick. Basically what I'm saying is I don't know if Ashraf was connected to Odyssey, but still, even if he was, everyone has an off day. So I have some hope because of him, because I really like Ashraf. But, some real quick, because if we do see combat and gameplay changes and whatnot, some things I want to see changed. And no, I'm not going to sit here and say everything. I mean, obviously, I hope the writing's a little bit better. I will say this, the voice actors for Cassandra and Alexios were both actually pretty good. Because I was playing as Alexios this time, and I'm listening to him. I'm like, you know what? I think the actor is going for it. I don't think the dialogue is that good, but I think he's going for it. I think he's actually giving a good performance. I enjoy him, not necessarily the words. The combat, I would very much like it not to be as floaty, if that makes sense. It looks like my character and the person I'm fighting look like they're on a green screen. You know, like, it looks like they're not a part of the environment. It's not as meaty and chunky. It feels so, you know, like, strikes feel like they have no impact. It's just like, okay, I'm slashing to do damage, slashing to do damage, slashing to do damage. You know, your combos always look the same, although I guess that's any action game. It's going to kind of, you know, you're going to start seeing repeated actions. But I don't know. I'd like to maybe see the combat animations change up a little bit because they were really stale in, you know, because you attacked one way and one way only anytime you entered a combo in Odyssey. I would like to see attacks and everything move back to the face buttons instead of being up on the triggers because, like, what, parry in Odyssey was L1, R1. That is a really weird combination. You know, I'd like to see, you know, square go back to, if we're going to be an action game, square be attack, triangle be heavy attack, circle be dodge, X be jump. Let's go back to that move. Hell, and then you can go back to doing that that free run up, free run down thing that you did in Unity and Syndicate, which I kind of forgot about until I was talking about it today. I loved that free run system. I really would like to see that come back. I don't like this whole, you're always sprinting, hold X to go up, down, whatever. It just, I don't know. I mean, just the way the character, even the way the character moved and interacted with the world, it always, it's like I said, it looks like you're on a green screen. And you're not actually in the environment you're running around in. It looked gross, in my opinion. I don't know. I mean, the opening cutscene with Leonidas and the 300 Spartans, you know, like when you put that spear through that guy's mouth, I forgot about that bit. It was really, looked really good. And then I think it was kind of downhill from there. But, you know, what I thought was really weird. I was in that opening sequence with Leonidas fighting with all those Persians, and I'm locked on to a guy in front of me. I hit attack thinking he's going to lunge at him with his spear because I thought I was within range. And Leonidas attacked to the side or behind him. He's targeting closer enemies, but not who I have locked on to. Why? Like, fix that. That's such a ridiculous decision, especially if you're going to have situations like in this game, or like you did in Odyssey, where you have these like big brawls and battles or whatever, where there's enemies all around you with people also on your side fighting. Can it, you know, pick it, let me pick who I want to attack and attack them, not every other direction. I don't know, I mean, obviously this isn't everything I want to see changed, but this is just some of the basic stuff that I would love to see changed and picked up as we move into Valhalla.
Hey, Jeff, pleasure to be here.
I'm so glad that you're here because I'm a huge fan of the series. After seeing the video that we just saw, I have literally hundreds of questions to ask you. But before we get into Valhalla itself, did I just see new Assassin's Creed gameplay for the first time?
No, we did not.
Absolutely. That was directly from the game in all its Viking Age glory.
Let's talk about the Viking Age because Assassin's Creed Odyssey.
That wasn't gameplay. That very much was, well, that could have been a freaking trailer. Oh, whatever. Oh, my God. You know what? You deserve downvotes, Xbox.
See Assassin's Creed Origin.
Also, clearly the dude presenting, not Ashaf, but the dude presenting, acting all, oh my gosh, is that gameplay? I'd look at that and go, really? That's what you're showing us? Oh, go off. Like, oh, the presenter, it's so fake.
These took place in antiquity. They were sun-drenched Mediterranean places. And this looks very different. It's a different time, different place. So what do you have for us with the Viking Age?
Yeah, so the Viking Age, it's named after one of history's most notorious warrior cultures. And this time period is highlighted by the invasion of England by this very large, hungry Viking horde. And at the time, England was a Dark Age tangle of broken warring kingdoms. So this was an absolutely brutal, pivotal moment in history that gave us the birth of the England we know today. So players can expect to fully live the Viking fantasy in a
and real quick earlier, I said, oh my gosh, those scenes, they looked like those weren't gameplay. Those could have been cutscenes. I'm not saying like, oh my gosh, the engine is so smooth that the cutscenes and the gameplay all look the same way. But I'm like, okay, like this is a cutscene. This is a panning shot or zooming in from behind Ivor. You know, but that seemed like they were all like inside like a mead hall or something, you know, kind of like panning around that pan. Okay, maybe that was, you know, like that was actually in gameplay and not in a cutscene. What did you show me? You didn't show me jack crap. You didn't show me how the game plays. You like, oh, again, I'm like, if this is trying to, like, ooh, look how this looks on Xbox, well, fine, but you didn't stay on any scene long enough for me to be able to tell what was you know, what the game's actually going to look like as I'm playing it and not a cutscene. It's like I said, this is a sizzle reel. This isn't what you're saying this was going to be. That is bullcrap is what that is. I'm making it clear that no, I'm not saying it's a good thing that, oh my gosh, the gameplay and the cutscenes look so good, so similar to each other. No, that's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is, really? That's what you're showing me? That doesn't even look like gameplay. It looks like I said, something out of a cutscene. Like, how am I supposed to discern anything? Like, this guy, I have hundreds of questions. How? We saw 15 seconds, and each thing was only about 3 seconds long. I mean, really? You have questions from that? I mean, the only questions you really have are setting-based.
A meticulously crafted journey in an Assassin's Creed world.
All right, so let's get a little bit more into this. There was a lot to take in that clip that we saw. I saw
Viking
long ships. I saw some very mean-looking axes. Previously, we saw a hidden blade. So let's talk about some of the key new features that you're bringing to the table with Assassin's Creed Valhalla.
Yeah, so our hero, Eivor, is a Viking raider who's going to leave the snowy mountains of Norway for the lush rolling hills of England, propelled by the goal of settling their people and growing a thriving settlement. Now, England at this time is a hostile place. So to succeed, players will go raiding using their longships and raiding party. They'll assault giant fortifications in epic battles. They'll have to gain alliances with kings and legendary Vikings, and they'll be faced with some very harsh choices as the leader of a community. Along with that...
Is anyone else getting weird, like, For Honor vibes out of this? This is something that I said, I think, during when we saw the world premiere trailer. This is something I said during my Assassin's Creed kind of like little special thing that I did for the weekly show. I want this to feel like an Assassin's game. I want that feeling to come back. And I'm sure there are going to be people who are going to tell me, AJ, get over it. The franchise has moved on. It's no longer Assassins and Templars. It's really not. It's basically an excuse to do period-setting video games, which honestly, I'm fine. Fine. You want to do a Viking game? Do a Viking game. Fine. I'm in for it. You want to do an Assassin's Creed game to attach to the franchise of Assassin's Creed. I get it. So you're shoehorning in the Abstergo stuff and all that. I get it. To some degree, I think Assassin's Creed 4 was that way. But again, Assassin's Creed 4 at least had that Assassin's Creed stuff. It felt like an Assassin's Creed game when it was being an Assassin's Creed game. Yeah, there was also all that really fun pirate stuff, and it was probably more a pirate game than an Assassin's game. But the Assassin stuff was still prevalent, and it was a hefty chunk of the game. Odyssey, in no freaking way was that game an assassin game. It wasn't. I will defend that statement till the day I die. I mean, hell, it's just like one of those articles we read. I think it was on Monday or Sunday or something, where they were saying, "Oh, the game. Thank God, it's leaving a." Paraphrasing, by the way. Thankfully, it's leaving being a stealth-focused game and being more of an action game. And I'm like, oh, so it's losing it's losing its identity. It's no longer an Assassin's Creed. It's like I said, you want to make an Ancient Greece game, make an Ancient Greece game. You didn't have to connect it to Assassin's Creed to try and sell it. Because that's kind of what that felt like. And I'm more and more afraid of anything. The thing that I'm most afraid of is that that's what this is going to be. This is just going to be another time that we're using Assassin's Creed to sell a game rather than make a good Assassin's Creed game. We're just using it to sell a historical piece. That's what I'm most afraid of. That's what really frustrates me, because that's what I want to see more of it than anything. I want to see Assassins v. Templars. I mean, fine, you want to center the Assassins v. Templars within this larger context of the Vikings and the Saxons. Fine, that's all good. We've seen that before. You know, I mean, we saw it in AC3, you know, I was talking with Rob Stone about that today. You know, I mean, he was kind of going, well, of course, another Assassin's Creed game where the English are the bad guys. And I'm like, well, you know, I mean, in AC3, I mean, you did fight people on the American side in that, you know, they were Templars as well. You know, it was kind of showing that whole duality. Anyone can be a Templar, but I guess at the same time, the crown was very heavily connected to the... was very, very heavily connected to the Templars. So, I mean, that's you know, you kind of take what you can get there. I kind of lost my train of thought where I was going with this. It's basically like I think we've gotten away from the Assassins and the Templars and all the stuff that makes Assassin's Creed Assassin's Creed. Honestly, I've heard that Brian Gotta has told me, you know, because he's hung around on the forums and stuff like that. He's told me that, you know, you're apparently the hoods are coming back. You know, or your character can wear a hood. Honestly, I have a feeling it's going to be hoods, as in it's kind of like the headgear from Odyssey where you can toggle it on or off. Honestly, I thought AC4, I think if you're going to do an optional hood, I think that's the best way to do it, where Edward would pop the hood in a restricted area, take it off when he's not in a restricted area. I thought that was probably one of the best ways to do it. But it's those iconic white robes and the hoods and everything. That's Assassin's Creed. You know, I get it. It's not the spirit of Assassin's Creed. Those are just the visuals. Fine. But even stuff like Odyssey didn't have the spirit of Assassin's Creed. We did away with the Hidden Blade. We did away with the robes. We did away with Assassins v. Templars and all this stuff. It was all about this hunting down this cult. It had almost nothing to do with it. I get it. We didn't see a lot of the Assassins v. Templar stuff in Origins, but we saw the beginnings of it. We saw a proto-assassin and a proto-kind of Templar order sort of thing. You know, we got to see that happen. We got to see a group who kind of had a very similar ideology to what the Templars would eventually take. And then you had Bayek, who was also sort of, the proto-assassin in Origins. And at the very end, he became basically the first assassin. Or maybe it was his wife that you technically consider the first assassin. But you get what I'm saying there. That's the whole thing of it. It still had the Assassin Templar sort of bare bones to it. I think that's why I liked Origins so much, I think it was the most back to basics Assassin's Creed game thematically than we've seen in a long time. But again, I miss the white robes and the hoods. Again, even Bayek had his form of the white robes and the hoods. And I mean, and again, you want to say the white robes wouldn't work for Valhalla? Fine. Unity got rid of the white coloring. You know, Arno at least basically wore a dark navy blue cloak, not cloak, but you know, a jacket and pants and everything. His look fit the day and age. You know, it was a little bit more colorful. I get it, it's French Revolution, things were a little bit more colorful. If it was just a sleek white costume, it would look maybe a little off. You know, Evie and Jacob wore their black. Clothes with the top hats and everything. Okay, again, they're trying to fit to the day and age. I understand that. You know, but every assassin's outfit or their robes have fit the time. You know, Altair's it was very subdued and very very relaxed, not a lot of ornamentation. But that's because, you know, his was more to fit in with monks and scholars who typically wore white robes. So again, that was why they did it. It was to fit in. By then, it just kind of been the outfit of the order. Excuse me. Ezio, you know, his was a little bit more ornamented. It kind of fit the more Italian Renaissance sort of era. Connor's robes were, you know, borrowed from not only his teacher, but his... But again, it had the ornamentation of his Native American heritage and everything. Maybe didn't fit in necessarily. He did kind of stick out in those. But again, it kept the look of a revolutionary era assassin. Again, same with Edward. You still had the base kind of assassin white robe and everything with the hood, and then all the pirate ornamentation on top of it. It's like I said, it was, you could always take that sort of that look and do your own thing with it and fit it into the time period. And like I said, Arno was a little different. Jacob and Evie, I get it. If they were wearing the robes, it would look weird. But even then, when they did the World War II stuff, where you played as that woman during World War II, that open world segment, I believe that was in Syndicate, that French woman, she wore green and wore a robe very similar to like what Arno wore. Like I said, in Origins, Bayek was very much a prototypical white sort of look to it that you would see in... That fit the Egyptian setting. And then they completely did away with it for that armor gear setting that they brought in Odyssey. They did completely away with all the visual stylings, the visual themes and everything that connected them to the assassins, they did away with them. I'm sorry, I'm getting so focused on the visuals because I think you see visuals first before you hear the stories. And it's like I said, like I just, those white robes and the hidden blades and everything are so iconic that I'm so used to it. That it's striking that it, when you really think about it, they completely did away with that. They not only did away with the style of game it is, they did away with the visual themes, and hell, they did away with the narrative themes as well. The Assassins, the Templars. Oh, well, we still have the modern day stuff and all that. And like, well, great, but what the hell explains the connect? But if I'm just playing the games, I have no idea what the hell happened in between Origins and Odyssey, because I swear they had to cover something in a book or something, because they do not carry directly over. I'm sorry, I keep going into the weeds. I'll try and bring myself back to my main point. It's just they have gotten so far away from what this franchise has been, and it's very sad. And I say this as a guy who's been a fan since one. I have been a fan of this franchise for so long, and I hope that maybe if I don't know I don't know everything about it. I don't claim to know everything about this franchise, all the lore, every character, the ins and outs of everything. But I am very passionate about this series. I do have a very strong connection with the series. It as just my evolution as a gamer, and it's very sad to me to see this kind of lose it. And I don't know. I mean, I'd like to see a return to that. You know, the armor. You know, look, if you want to have interchangeable armor and all that, fine. But still keep it so that we aren't just killing some random person and taking their gear. No, was it Eivor or Ivor? I keep trying to pronounce. I'm gonna keep pronouncing Ivor, but it's probably Eivor. Either way, you know, have Eivor. The only time you can get new like chess pieces or new gear is either have it gifted to them or have it. You know, because I mean, there were some weird costumes. You know, like Edward. If you solved all the Stele puzzles, you got that cool like bulletproof magnet armor. That wasn't very Assassin's Creed-y. But you know, okay, you want to have him be gifted, him or her, gifted some stuff? Okay, fine, you can do it that way. Have them, you know, only get new armor through crafting or something. But still have that Assassin's Creed aesthetic. I think there are ways that you could have an armor system, you can fit it into an RPG-like world without having it be basically a loot shooter or a loot slasher or whatever, basically the feel that Odyssey had. It completely killed it. It's like I said, you lose that visual identity. It's like I said, I want to see the Assassin's Templar things for the narrative identity to come back. I mean, hell, I'd love to see a heavier focus on stealth and fixing it. I don't want to say fixing the stealth. I mean, the stealth in Odyssey, everything was in such tight quarters a lot of the times. A lot of the times there was just somebody always looking somewhere. Like, I'm like, okay, I can get in and I get one stealth kill. That's about it. Maybe two if I'm lucky. You know, it's just, plus enemies see you from really far away. Like shadows don't seem to mean much in that game. It was very odd. But yeah, I'd love to see stealth really make a comeback in it as well, and bring back the gameplay identity as well. I mean, those are the three areas that I'd really like to see Assassin's Creed come back in. I apologize for that long-winded rant, because I know I've made that before, but it's on my mind. I had to get it out.
Where we've reinvented combat to be visceral, brutal,
buzzwords,
enemy variety, dual wielding weapons. We have a new fresh take on player progression, gear, and weapon systems. We're effectively pushing
every
single envelope to
show
deliver
it to me.
This incredible
show me combat. System. Show me these gear systems.
My ears. Thank you so much.
Well, he didn't fucking tell you anything. Fuck you. I'm sorry, I get it. I'm guilty of this. I'm guilty of this sometimes when I'm just trying to look for something to say. I'm trying to move along or whatever. That I'm like, oh, that looks cool. That looks cool. That's neat. I have times like that instead of really breaking down why I find that neat, why I find this, that, the other thing. I'm trying to fix that. I'm trying to catch myself when I'm doing that. That's part of my evolution of doing this. But right there, And again, I get it. I'm looking at this more from a you're showing me gameplay and everything sort of thing, and not what this really is. And this is a marketing tool. This is more of a marketing tool than showing us something. But it's still acting like, oh my gosh, this is so cool. All he did was say buzzwords. Okay, how is it more visceral? You said we can dual wield weapons. Okay, well, what can we dual wield? Is it true that we can dual wield two shields? And if so, why would I want to do that? Give me an idea of how the game works. Like, you don't have to fully explain every system, but if you're going to mention it, I don't know, give me a little rundown of it. You know, because you mentioned it, you know, we're going to have these settlements, we're going to have these diplomatic sort of ties with characters. Well, okay, exactly, but what does that entail? Maybe if you showed us something instead of just a little sizzle reel, maybe we could infer something. But you're not but it's that sizzle reel mixed with the buzzwords, mixed with this dude acting, oh my gosh, this is so cool. No. Dive into some stuff. Maybe this is why this, I don't know. You feel like this should have been a slam dunk. You'd think.
Whole show we've been talking about the Xbox Series X. We're talking about next gen. So as a creative director, as someone creating a huge epic game, how do you take advantage of this new hardware?
Well, Assassin's Creed has always been committed to new technologies in order to push the most immersive experiences we possibly can. And so to have something like incredibly fast loading times means that we can remove some of that friction from the immersion and create a game that's much more immersive. Norway and Dark Ages England are breathtaking living worlds. So to be able to push them further to their incredible potential, this is really wonderful for us. It's wonderful for our players. And additionally, I'm very happy to confirm that we are also offering smart delivery, which allows you to purchase the game once and play it on your Xbox One and the Xbox Series X.
That is great news.
Okay, I know. I'm going off into mini rants of why this is annoying me every 20 seconds. But again, that answer, he didn't say anything. He didn't say anything there. I mean, he's these are breathtaking. Well, okay, but will the PS5 just look like ass? Tell me. Is that what you're saying? Are you saying that it'll only look good on the Xbox? Well, no, it's going to be on both. So I'm assuming it's going to look good on the PlayStation as well. And I'm sure somebody's going to tell me that somebody can tell me. Well, AJ, I think he's saying because of the Xbox is pure power of this. I'm like, okay, but I can pull up developers telling you how great that the PlayStation is for the things they're doing, that how it's going to change development and everything. And guess what? A lot of that stuff is maybe it's being reported on by PlayStation outlets, but it's not being pushed forward by PlayStation. It's not PlayStation, you know, doing this little demo for their new console and say, hey, look, here's this game, and oh, developer, what do you think about our platform as I'm standing right in front of you? And they're gonna do the smart business thing and be nice to Microsoft and all that, not burn bridges. And that's kind of what Ashraf did right there. I'm not holding it against him. I get it, you want to play things close to the vest till you're really ready to announce things yourself, but you shouldn't have done this if you weren't really ready to announce details of your game. I mean, this was hyped that this is when we were going to find out stuff about Valhalla. I've not found out shit about this because this is all marketing bullcrap. This is all sizzle words and buzzwords and whatnot. It's buzzwords and sizzle reels. There we go. But it's like I said, that last little bit. It's like faster loading times. Oh, it helps immersion. Oh, yeah. Again, I'm mad at this presentation, not these guys. Like I know I've said some mean things about the presenter, and I'm not trying to be mean to him. It's not his fault. It's just this presenting style is really irritating to me, is when they do shit like this.
News, I think, for all the Assassin's fans out there, they'll be able to enjoy it on the hardware they have now, maybe on the hardware that they are looking forward to getting later this year. Thank you so much, Ashraf Ismail, for joining us and for sharing the very first details on Assassin's Creed Valhalla. I cannot wait to see more.
Absolutely. It's my pleasure.
When are you actually going to show us stuff for it? Wait, tell me that. I will say I like the logo and that
seen so world premiere trailer is really cool. Showcasing gameplay for Xbox Series X. So let's go to Malik right now with Robert Karp from Codemasters to talk Dirt 5.
All right, everyone, just a few minutes ago, you saw the reveal trailer of Dirt 5, and I kind of was left speechless, but I'm going to have to get it together here because we're going to dive even deeper into everything. Right now, we have Robert Karp, who is Dirt 5's development director, in the driver's seat to talk about what's next for the series. Robert, how are you?
I'm very well. How are you, Malik?
I'm doing great. Excited to dive into this. Now, Dirt 5, obviously the newest game in the series. Let's start with locations because kind of the backdrop is kind of important for a racing game. So where are we going to be going in Dirt 5?
So you saw from the trailer, we had New York, then we went to China, and then we went to Norway.
Okay, I'm sorry, just because we're already running long, and I got in some rants there on the Assassin's Creed end. I'm sorry about that, by the way, if anybody's like, oh, God, here he goes off on Assassin's Creed again. We're going to skip over the dirt thing, because I think it's a dirt game. It's a racing game. Come on. It's going to be, here's some cool, you know, it looks good. It's a racing game. It's whatever. So I'm actually going to skip this segment. You can, again, find down in the description a link to this this video.
This will give you rewards and pay you to race for them. And talking you through that will be your mentor. He'll help guide you, give you tips and hints. And that's voiced by Troy Baker.
Greetings from the booth, everybody.
And there's really only one person to have as the protagonist to Troy Baker, who's the nemesis, and that's Nolan North.
Thrilled to be working with Codemasters on this, playing a very pivotal character, per usual. Also, you're going to see some pretty recognizable faces in this game, so you don't want to miss it.
So as you race, you'll have to beat him if you want to win the career.
Oh, that's super exciting.
Oh, yeah, that's neat. There's a career mode. I'm kind of glad I kind of bumped up against that. But, come on. Yeah, like I said, I am sorry that I am kind of skipping over the dirt stuff. It's just for the sake of time, just so this doesn't end up accidentally being 2 hours long, and I have a shot at getting this uploaded today. It's probably not going to happen, but whatever. It's already like 10 o'clock.
And the medium promises to keep us guessing and our hearts racing. Here to tell us more about the game is Jack, game producer from the Bluebird team. Thank you so much for joining us, Jack.
Hi, hello.
Another reason I was, this is probably one of the most interesting things I saw here.
Approach to the psychological horror genre.
In our first psychological horror that was Layers of Fear, it was, the main topic was, what can you sacrifice for your family? Can you sacrifice yourself, or you want to sacrifice yourself for your passion to fulfill yourself?
Oh, this is by the people who made Layers of Fear. Ooh.
And then the main topic, it was, if I'm still human, if my mind maybe is digitalized. Or psychological horror that was Layers of Fear. It was, the main topic was.
Sorry, I was talking. I want to make sure I heard something correctly.
Yourself, or you want to sacrifice yourself for your passion to fulfill yourself. The second our game, it was Observer, and then
Observer.
The main topic, it was, if I'm still human, if my mind maybe is digitalized, or if I have robotic parts, where is the line, you know, like in the body horror stuff.
I think I've seen people play Observer. It's really kind of, it's an interesting game. I can't remember enough about it to tell you what it's about, but it's an interesting game.
And in the Blair Witch, of course, there was a witch, there was the forest.
Oh, these guys also did Blair Witch. Oh.
Everyone loves, but in the main topic, in the psychological horror stuff, it was PTSD. So for the medium, we have like two worlds in our game, real world and spirit world. We play as a medium that can see these both realities. So we can think like somebody can be a really good guy, but maybe inside it's not. And when you play as a medium, you have a really unique perspective to find out what is inside of other people and all what happens in different places.
For the medium, we heard that you teamed up with legendary music composer Akira Yamaoka. Can you tell us more about that partnership and how that influenced the game?
Yeah, he's the best now, of course, for composing the music for Silent Hill series. And what was most important for us, it was his work on Silent Hill 2, because Silent Hill 2, for most of our team, is the best horror game ever, and it's one of our main references when we think about atmosphere in the medium, because in one way, his music is, you know, heavy, disturbing, oppressive, and in another way, it can be nostalgic, emotional, and melodic. And to bump it up more, we cooperate Akira with our composer Arkadiusz Rejkowski that create our others scores for our other games and mix these two approaches together to fill up our two worlds and our different points of view. So it was really, it is, and it was really great fun.
this game is really characterized by those two worlds. Can you talk to us more about the story and these two worlds and how the players can look forward to that?
Yeah, so you play as a Marianne, and she's...
Okay, see, this is the interview this is what I wanted for Ashoff, to actually have him sit down and talk about this. I mean, I get it. They just announced their game. It's a whole thing. They're probably not ready to fully go into details or everything just yet. But still, then it shouldn't have been included here. That's what I'm saying. If they couldn't do something like this, they shouldn't have been included here. It was a waste of time. It was, I get it. It's to draw eyes. But at the end, when you draw eyes and then you know, come here, you'll get a free car. And then you know, end up like an R. They're like, well, we said a car. We never said it would, you know, it'd have an engine. You know, like that it, you know what I mean? It kind of feels like, you know, they pulled the rug out from under us with that. That just... But this, this is what I wanted. This is more interesting to me.
And like, she can cope with this, that she goes, or that she can see the spirit world, the second world. But she's like haunted by really one specific vision that she tried to solve. And she has some kind of a hint that the answers can be in abandoned communist vacation resort. It's like an old hotel. So she go there, and then she need to, you know, find out how the vision is connected with this place and what dark mystery is there. And there two worlds came up, because our real world and our real world setting is like, it's Poland, late 80s, Krakow. Krakow is a very important city for Poland history. It was a city of kings. And it's, of course, city of Blueberry. We have company here, we live here, we love the city. And you know, it's a free Poland in that time, but because in the 80s and before, we live under the regime, communist regime, and there was like no free of speech, there was, everything was censored. And when you play as a medium, you have this unique opportunity to see even further than normal people, because you see the spirit world. And spirit world is like dark mirror of our world, like when all your like anger, urges, secrets are reflected there. So it also hostile world in some way. So only medium can, like, you know, solve some puzzles, some mysteries, and survive that kind of encounter.
Horror is really a genre that can really take advantage of some very immersive gameplay. What are some of the Xbox Series X features that the Bluebird team has harnessed to make sure that you can deliver this epic next-gen title with the medium?
Yeah, of course. First of all, it's the horsepower is the hardware. So having that powerful stuff as a foundation for our game, it's like, it's awesome, because we spent a lot of years to thinking about this game, how we can fulfill our dreams about it. But we have a problem with the platform. Like, everything we thought, it's too weak to fulfill our vision. But then Xbox Series X came up, and we thought, yeah, this is perfect match for us. And now a lot of doors were open for us to be like, creative and do the game as we wanted. And like, the second most important stuff is the seamless gameplay, like, you know, steady FPS and no loading screens, because, you know, you have like immersive horror cinematic experience. And you have two worlds. You can travel between them. You can travel between them. You can travel between the levels and the whole story. And not having any, you know, loading screens and any FPS drops, it's like awesome. And of course, we use Xbox Series X in different ways, in many different ways. But I will leave this maybe more for the future. So stay tuned, guys.
Ooh, mysterious. I think I speak for all the fans when I say that I'm super excited to play the medium when it launches on the Xbox Series X. Thank you so much for joining us today, Jack.
Also, thank you very much.
Hey, I want to give a special thank you to all of our developers from around the world who pulled out all the stops.
I love this guy. He's fun. I do like this guy.
Series X gameplay with all of you today. It's also great to see how many developers are taking advantage and leveraging things like smart delivery, really putting our fans first. And of course, we're doing that with all of our Xbox Game Studios titles. And as I said, we're not taking the summer off. Today is just the beginning. It's time to get hyped, because in July, it's Xbox Game Studios world premieres, reveals, lots of news. Mark your calendars. We'll see you then.
Okay. I don't know. Part of me is kind of expecting something very similar to what we just saw. I don't want to bash on it too much because I get it. Like I said, it's a marketing pull. It's all that. But at the same time, he's like, ooh, we saw gameplay. Did we? I mean, I think we saw a lot of cutscenes and trailers. And like, it feels like this was billed one way, we saw another, but then they're also talking like, oh, we saw this gameplay, we saw this, we saw that. If you're trying to figure out what I'm doing right now, I'm you know what? I decided, screw it. It's already like 10:30. There's no way in hell I'm getting this video up before midnight. So you know what? Why the hell not? We'll check out the section for Dirt. I it kind of piqued my interest seeing that it's gonna have Troy Baker and Nolan North. Like, you put those two in a game. Ah, goddammit, I'm sold. I mean, the whole thing about Medium, I don't really have a lot to say about it, even though I did really like that interview. Just because I found him very interesting. I found him very, very compelling. He's clearly very passionate about his project. I'm just really curious to see what they're going to be able to do with that. Like, you know, what kind of game is it going to be? Is it going to be more puzzle platformer? Is there going to be like survival horror aspects of it? Is it like exactly how the game is going to work? I'm very curious about that. They're going to do that whole world shift thing where, I come up to a gap in the real world, but then the spirit world, there's like a way around it and I can, traverse areas by phasing between worlds and whatnot. Excuse me. It's a cool idea. The game looks neat. Really don't have much else to say. I like the idea of the themes and everything that they're trying to deal with. But either way, let's move on to some less heavy stuff. Let's finish this off. Let's look at Dirt 5.
Minutes ago, you saw the reveal trailer of Dirt 5, and I kind of was left speechless, but I'm going to have to get it together here because we're going to dive even deeper into everything. Right now, we have Robert Karp, who is Dirt 5's development director, in the driver's seat to talk about what's next for the series. Robert, how are you?
I'm very well. How are you, Malik?
I'm doing great. Excited to dive into this. Now, Dirt 5, obviously the newest game in the series. Let's start with locations, because kind of the backdrop is kind of important for a racing game. So where are we going to be going in Dirt 5?
So you saw from the trailer, we had New York, then we went to China, and then we went to Norway. We've got lots more China. Environments than that. Each of the environments are bespokely created based in real worlds for the tracks and the event types that we play in there. So for New York, for example, you saw us racing over the East River when it was frozen in winter. But you can play in New York in the summer and spring and autumn. There you'll be able to race along Roosevelt Island on a couple of different tracks. It gives you a totally different experience. After that, we go to Brazil. We take in the favelas and Christ the Redeemer. We have tracks in Europe, in Italy, in Arizona. So there's really a really wide range of tracks, with a really colorful and wide different color palette that offer really interesting different experiences.
Super cool. I'm excited to see all the different locations as well as how the weather's going to change. I'm personally a New York boy, so I'm excited to race in New York. But it is a racing game after all, so let's talk about some of the cars that we're going to be able to jump into.
We have one of the widest ranges of vehicles that we've had in a dirt game ever before. So you've got the rally cars that you saw some buggies in China. We also have sprint cars, which are really cool and interesting. They go around ovals, they only turn left. Each of their wheels is like a different size, with the front one at the left the smallest, the back one at the right the biggest. They've got 900 horsepower, and you just basically drift all the way around the oval, kicking up big plumes of smoke, which is really fun.
Oh, that's super cool. Of course, everyone's gonna be excited for more, right? More cars, more.
I mean, I guess my biggest one, I mean, I don't have a big connection with the Dirt franchise, so I mean, I'm not really sure if there's a lot of customization or messing around with things like that, but I think that's my biggest question. I mean, are we going to be able to, like, customize our cars? And because, I mean, he mentioned that there's going to be kind of like a campaign or whatever, or a career mode, excuse me. So I'm curious to hear more about that.
Different types of vehicles. That's pretty cool. Now let's talk about the experience when the players jump into the game. What are some things that veteran Dirt franchise players are going to notice? And what are some things that, you know, they're going to notice for the first time ever?
So I think jumping into the career, they're going to notice the kind of agency or the choice of the different events. But some of the new things that are new to the franchise, and one of the ones I'm most excited about, is four-player split screen. So in career or in arcade mode, where you can pick your event type and your vehicle type and your time of day, how quickly the time changes and what the weather's going to change, you can play that with your friends. So on launch day, when you get your Xbox Series X home, you boot it up, You invite a few friends over, you can all race together.
That's super exciting. Four-player split screen, something that we always want to see, because it's always good to have your friends around and play some games on the couch. That's pretty cool. Now let's shift gears.
You know, I've always talked with people the difference between couch co-op and online co-op. I don't know why. I'm like, look, I'm not really a big social person. I don't like being around people generally. Yeah, oddly enough, I can handle couch co-op so much easier than I can handle online co-op. For some reason, it's just that online thing of being on the microphone and not seeing the other person and being able to like really read them out. It's really weird to me. It's really uncomfortable. And again, it could just be how I am, but I love couch co-op. It's really nice that they're bringing that aspect back for those of us who don't necessarily want to play online with our friends, that, you know, we can get together, we can have beers, we can have, you know, food and hang out together and play a game like that. It's that's the better way that I prefer, you know, like communal gaming in a way.
A bit into the career mode. Obviously, the Dirt franchise is known for the career mode and taking you through a bunch of different races. Can you talk a bit about the story there? And I hear Little Birdie has told me that there's a very dynamic duo in the voiceover booth. Let's talk about that as well.
There is a dynamic duo. So one of the things that I really enjoy about the career is the real world sponsors. So as you race, you'll sign up to real world sponsors who'll give you rewards and pay you to race for them. And talking you through that will be your mentor. He'll help guide you, give you tips and hints, and that's voiced by Troy Baker.
Greetings from the booth, everybody.
And there's really only one person to have as the protagonist to Troy Baker, who's the nemesis, and that's Nolan North.
Thrilled to be working with Codemasters on this, playing a very pivotal character, per usual. Also, you're going to see some pretty recognizable faces in this game, so you don't want to miss it.
So as you race, you'll have to beat him if you want to win the career.
Oh, that's super exciting.
I'm sorry. I don't think I can beat Nathan Drake.
Career, but two, I feel like a lot of players are going to be happy about having both Troy Baker and Nolan North in the same video game. So that's going to be pretty, pretty exciting.
Uncharted
now,
4.
Again, we're super happy.
Uncharted
that
4.
Dirt 5 is part of the reveal of the first gameplay for Xbox Series X. So let's talk about some of the things that we're going to see that are specific to Xbox Series X.
So Dirt 5, you'll be able to play at 4K at 60 FPS, but there'll also be an option for 120 Hz mode. So, you know, gamers know frame rate counts. 120 Hz in racing, that's where the action's at. On top of that, Dirt 5 will leverage the smart delivery technology. So you buy the game on Xbox One, you can play on Xbox Series X as soon as you get the new console.
Sorry about that. I don't know why I did that.
Xbox Series X, and you go over, you have an Xbox One in your house or in another room and you want to play in there, you can play Xbox One. So you'll always be playing the best version. And lastly is the fast loading. So that means that you get into the game almost instantaneously from turning on the console. No more waiting. You're in there, you're racing straight away.
I love everything that you just said there. You buy the game, you get the best version for the platform that you own. You get in the game, loading times are a thing that everyone hates, so minimizing that is fantastic. And then you get to choose between 4K 60 and 120 frames per second. So that is pretty cool. Again, Robert, thank you so much for stopping by. I got to say that I probably speak for everyone watching when I say that we're super excited to see Dirt 5 on Xbox Series X coming up this year. Thank you so much for stopping by.
Thanks for having me.
All right, we've already seen so many games so far, but
All right. So yeah, we've seen everything here. I mean that last little bit's interesting. I mean, again, it's always what about the Xbox Series X? I mean, I stand by it. I don't think it's going to be that extremely different of a presentation on PlayStation. I mean, maybe not, because I don't know if somebody, there are going to be people, you know, like really eagle-eyed people out there who are going to say, well, PlayStation can't go to true 4K, and I'm like, okay, but I'm sitting here looking at them. There are minor differences, but I mean, they both look good. Okay, fine. I just care whether or not it looks good. You know, that's my whole thing. So, it's just, you know, like right there. You know, I think he made the best pitch for why it's better on Xbox Series X maybe than PlayStation. Because again, I don't know exactly how PlayStation runs. I don't know if they can do that 120 whatever that he was mentioning or the. But again, it's the. A whole idea of how much can the human eye catch, and you know, it's for people like me who visuals matter, but it's not necessarily the that it needs to be. What is it? I want it to look good, but it doesn't have to look like a fucking painting. That's my whole thing with it. So I think he made the best argument because, you know, it's like the guy from Medium. He's like, well, it's the hardware that lets us do it. I'm like, okay, so are you saying the PlayStation is going to suck? Same thing with Ashaf. I'm like, really? Are you saying the PlayStation can't run this game, or what's going on? Because it's going to be on the PlayStation, apparently. Same with this game. It's just a whole thing. I get it. Again, it's one more time. It's all marketing for the Xbox. Overall, this presentation, I found it very mixed signals. It's like, oh, it's gameplay, 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 but we get trailer, trailer, trailer. I don't know. I mean, I saw some interesting games. Oddly enough, a lot of them are third-party games, which just makes me wonder, okay, you haven't sold me on Xbox, though. Like, okay, it's cool that you did this, but you haven't sold me on Xbox. Like, that's the thing, because showing me all these third-party games, like, oh, it's better on Xbox, it's better on Xbox, better on Xbox. Okay, fine, I like my PlayStation better. If I was only going to buy one, I'd still buy the PS5. I'm being honest. I'd play the PS5, and I'd soup up my PC. If I was only going to buy one. I mean, clearly I'm buying both just because that's what I do. That's the whole thing with the channel. I focus on console gaming more than I do on PC gaming, so that's why I am still souping up my PC. But that's, well, technically an old PC. That's beside the point. This didn't do what I think it had to do. Granted, they are going to be doing something. I think they said, did they say June or July? I think they said July. But they're doing something for the actual Xbox studio, so I think that's important to make mention of. Yeah, it's a whole thing, but at the end of the day, like I said, this didn't sell me on Xbox, and I think that's what they really need to do to a lot of people who are on the fence about it, like me. I don't want to say on the fence like me, but you get what I'm saying. These people who are like, well, you know, which one am I going to go with? And I don't think this would necessarily sell people like that. At least that's my opinion. So tell me what you guys thought down in the comments below. Thanks for watching. As always, social media is in the description. Like, comment, not already, please subscribe to the channel. Stay tuned more next time. Until then, my name is AJ Gills, the Summon the Game Channel. I'm out.